In this video, something about an oscillator that I made. I made it in a certain way in the past, and it was published many years ago. And here is the circuit, the first circuit that I tried many years ago, but it was made with an NPN transistor, and now I wanted to get the coil on the minus, so I made it with a PNP transistor, and that's what this video is all about. It will perhaps be a sloppy video because I don't show, say, a successful circuit, but a circuit under construction and, say, with certain problems, especially regarding the pureness of the waveform. Anyway, you see the test circuit. It's one of the, say, classical oscillator circuits. You can find them on the World Wide Web and in books, etc., etc. And here, this is an old, say, radio magazine of 1968, and here we find quite a lot of oscillator circuits. They were made with tubes, but of course the classical oscillator circuits are the Colpitts oscillator, the Hartley oscillator, the Hood-Kuhn oscillator, the Clapp oscillator, and of course you can say translate all these, say, tube circuits into transistor circuits. And here on the next page we get some idea. The Hartley or the three-point oscillator, and here the another type of oscillator, and I've published many oscillators on my YouTube channel, also this type of oscillator, but anyway, I think we have here in my video to do with the Hartley or three-point oscillator, and that's here. And I made it with a buffer stage, and the reason was that when you, say, try to take the signal out of that oscillator, the oscillation stopped. So I had to use a buffer, and that buffer was made with a BC547B. And the original oscillator was made with a PNP transistor because I wanted to get the coil to ground for stability reasons, and that was the BC556B. Both transistors have an amplification factor of approximately 300. And it worked very well. I have to say that the coil that I use here does not have a parallel capacitor. That means that the natural inductance between all the windings is, say, the natural parallel capacitance. And there are more videos on my YouTube channel where you can see how to make such a good coil for all kinds of purposes. Here again, something about all the different oscillator circuits: Hartley, Colpitts, Electron, Seiler, Clapp, Wacker, and there are more names. And when you study, say, 1920 books, you will find more names. Anyway, they can all be brought back to, say, three types of three types, not times, but types of oscillator circuits. So in this video I want to show the problems, so not the solutions, perhaps some solutions. The circuit is published as it is. The output level is say 0.3 volts and the frequency is set by the natural capacitance of the coil. That's here. So the circuit again. When you look at the circuit, you see this oscillator circuit, and you can take the signal out of the emitter lead to the buffer, but you can also take the signal out of the collector lead to the buffer. And we need here a very, very tiny value capacitor to make that the oscillator doesn't stop when it is loaded at its collector with another electronic circuit or at its emitter. So let's look at the circuit here again. Here is the waveform at the moment. We are on 636 kilohertz. That's a good frequency. And the frequency is given by this coil. And I want to take out the ferrite rod now and look at the same time to the scope and the counter what happens. And when you see this, it means that you have a, say, kind of critical oscillator. The quality factor of the coil plays a role. Anyway, it's important, of course, that we don't have here a parallel capacitor to the coil that sets the frequency. With a parallel capacitor, it will be in a somewhat broader frequency range, and perhaps it will be more stable anyway. One of the problems of this circuit, or not the problems, but simply the issues that have everything to do with this type of oscillator. And here you can see that you can say take out a signal here out of the collector and here out of the emitter of the buffer. Let's do that. Now is it's the say counter is connected to the emitter and the scope is connected to the collector. So now both to the emitter, and that's what we see here. So damped oscillation signal, and we can say lift up the supply voltage. Let's see what happens. At least we see when we lift up the supply voltage to 18 volts a better sine wave. And that's of course always good. That's say one of the properties of the circuit. So let's go to a higher voltage. And when we go to a too high voltage, say 25 volts, the output level diminishes. And here it is more or less at its optimum, given the pureness of the sine wave. And the voltage applied, that's 21 volts approximately. Anyway, let's see what happens when we change the value of this potentiometer. And you see that quite sloppy circuit, the 1K potentiometer here. And I've soldered in another resistor here. You can see that here, 1K and 680 ohms. To make that this potentiometer cannot give out a too high voltage to the circuit. But anyway, let's try what happens when we change the value of that potentiometer, and here we see distortion. Here is pure, and of course when the voltage changes to an oscillator circuit, the frequency also will change somewhat. Has everything to do with the kind of oscillator that we are talking about. It's a free running oscillator. So to get a good pure sine wave, we can set here with that potentiometer a certain specific voltage here to the emitter of the PNP transistor, the first transistor. Well, is there more to tell? Well, there's a lot of more to tell. I found, for instance, all kinds of strange phenomenon. So let's see what happens when we connect here the scope to this output, and that's the output on the collector here of the buffer transistor. So here, and when we do that, we see a beautiful, very very properly amplified sine wave on the same frequency. That frequency is set by the coil, of course. A beautiful sine wave here. At the output here of the BC547B, the collector, via a 100 picofarad capacitor. So here we have a kind of diminished output, and here we have a fierce output. And I've drawn in the circuit here two switches. They are, say, experimental. Of course, don't close both switches at the same time. Then we have a fierce shortcut in the buffer stage, in the second transistor of the buffer stage. But open one and close one, or open this and close this one. Then you can compare the different output levels of the buffer stage at the emitter. That's in general low impedance, very low impedance, and at the collector, that is also kind of low impedance, but there is say a difference. Anyway, that was more or less all to tell. My camera runs out. Here again, all the different say oscillator circuits that you can make. You can find more info on the Hoogblad web, etc., etc. And of course, with a coil that has a higher inductance, you will go to lower frequencies, and that's the aim of this video. I want to make an oscillator circuit that works between, say, 20 kilohertz and approximately 1 megahertz in a very, very simple way. And to make it simple, that's always difficult.